Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place.
When we all
get to heaven,
what a day of rejoicing that will be.
One of the things we have to keep in mind is the church today, just as it was 2,000 years ago, was under fire. And that there were many of our brothers and sisters who lived in that particular time and at that particular time who suffered much. And it's our turn, it is our time now. This is a time when we, as God's people, have to make a stand. We have to allow our voices to be heard. And there are some things that we have to do. As the Apostle Paul was talking to the church at Ephesus, and I'll say this later on as we get into our lessons this week, as the Apostle Paul talked to Ephesus, he knew he was talking to folks who had some issues. When you go over to the book of Revelation, as John, who received the revelation from our Lord, the apocalypse that was sent to him, he told the folks there at Ephesus that they had left their first love. And the Apostle Paul also gave some dubious distinctions, saying that of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after them. If there was ever a time when we see those things which are perverse being spoken, it is this time that we live now. This past week, while I sat in my office there in Nashville, I had some visitors. And they were coming because there is a bill that is going through the House and Senate about bathrooms. Now, you wouldn't think that in 2016, in an educated society where men and women have universities, the quality and the character of the universities that we have in the state of Tennessee, that something as basic as gender identification would be something argued on the floor of the House and Senate. Well, as I said in my office, I had some visitors, and Liz told me that you have folks here from a certain group that want to talk to you. Well, it's a public building, and I'm a public official, and everybody that comes there has a right to be heard, and no matter who they are or where they're from in the state of Tennessee, especially, I give them time and I give them ear. And as these individuals talked to me, one fellow said that I am a woman that is trapped in a man's body. Someone else said that, well, I knew that I was a man since I was 3 years old. And as I sit there looking at these individuals, I said a silent prayer for them, because basically I'm looking at folks that Satan has had his way with, and people who are in a strong delusion, as the Apostle Paul told our brethren at Thessalonica, where he says that God will send you. When you refuse the truth and you refuse to accept those things that are clearly set before us, those things that we can be assured of, God said, I'll send you strong delusions that you will believe a lie. And if you go back and do Greek, and you know your Greek is younger than mine, mine's about 40 years old, but if you go back, it speaks of energy of deceit. Basically, God says, I'm the one between you and the devil. I'm the one that is showing you the way and teaching you the way and strengthening you so that you can make a stand on those things that are right, and those things that are right for you, that make you a better person, that make you and allow you to understand why you're here and what you're supposed to be doing while you're here. You refuse the truth. And the Lord said that the truth, he is the embodiment of the truth. And he said, you shall know the truth. And it is the truth that liberates you or sets you free. Well, it's obvious that these folks were sitting there and they are captives in the devil's prison camp. And I'm thinking, as I said to them, and we had an intelligent discussion, I said, how can we talk about this? I said, is there anything basic? And one person said that I'm a scientist or I'm a doctor. I forget exactly what her credentials were. And my thing was, how can you talk about anything and even use the word science if there are no absolutes? And she got quiet for a moment. I said, if there are no absolutes, And now, you know, there are no absolutes in gender. There is no male, no female. There is nothing absolute. And if everything's up in the air as far as personal opinion and personal choices are concerned, how in the world are we going to run a society that way? Well, we had a very interesting discussion, and they were very interestingly dressed as they sat there in my office. But basically, the discussion is I get up on Monday, I play football, you know, with Bubba, Leroy, Cockroach, and Skillet all for ever since we were in the first grade, and now all of a sudden, I decide that I'm a woman. And so I'm 6'4", 200 pounds, I put on a pair of 15 pumps and a big dress, and let my hair grow, and I say that I am a woman, and therefore I am entitled to use the woman's facilities. Or a young lady can cut her hair and change her attire and say, because I have decided that I am a man, that I can use the male facilities. Well, you know, this is what's happening right now all around our country. And there are a lot of discussions that are going to have to be had, but at the end of the day, you are the first line of defense. Because I told the folks at Coleman Avenue, I said, I'm not going to get in a lot of silly arguments, but one thing I'm going to make sure is that the children of this congregation are not involved in that because they are taught. You're the first line of defense because you deny the devil new souls. You deny him new souls. You deny him these beautiful girls that are sitting here on this row and all of these beautiful babies and children that are sitting in this audience. You deny him any new blood, new souls, a new people to mess up. You deny him your teenagers. You deny him your young ladies. You raise them in the nurture and admonition of the Lord along with your boys. You teach them virtue and modesty. And you teach them how to be a women that God can point to like he pointed to his servant Job and say that those are my servants, those are my children, and they are the next generation of the Lord's church. So as the Apostle Paul talked to our brethren there in the book of Ephesians, chapter 6, he realized that those brethren were in a big city, that there were a lot of folks who were surrounded by opulence and wealth and prestige and entitlement, but then there was immorality and perversion, all types of things. In Rome, if you had the ability, you could have anything you wanted to there in the Roman Empire. So the Apostle Paul, as he's talking to the brethren, he begins his thesis as chapter 6 is divided there by saying, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. He begins with that which is the future. And I want each of you, and I know you know it because of this church's storied history. You haven't been able to last as long as you have and do as well as you have and have an impact on the brotherhood as long as you have by not understanding that you have to raise your children to take your place. I tell folk all the time, I look at my grandchildren and I tell them that our children are our ambassadors. We send them to a place and to a time that we will not see. When I was up here the last time, I told you this because we talked about the family. And there is absolutely nothing more important going on in the United States of America right now than for God's people to make a stand. So as the Apostle Paul was talking to them, Paul said, finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Our might is in the power of the Lord, the power of the word, the power of understanding those things that are written, the power of allowing it to be engrafted or implanted in our hearts to where it makes the changes that are necessary for us to be the type of people that can do exactly what God told us to do, what the Lord told us to do, and that is to be an example, be a pattern, be light, and be salt. And that's our job. And nobody's going to do it as well as we do it. And if we don't do it, it's not going to get done. We see those in denominationalism right now as they cower and they prostrate themselves to the current distresses and the current political correctness and the current digressions and the current perversions and the corruptions that we see all around us. They're compromising one at a time. They're changing their long-held rules and laws and creeds to go along to get along so they can keep their organizations alive. Well, we're the Lord's people. Our organization is not held alive by those things that are of this world, but it's held alive by the power of Christ. So when Paul was speaking, he wanted us to understand that we ought to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. In essence, we have to strengthen those things that remain. And don't you understand, as I look over this audience, I'm looking at God's people. I'm looking at the best people on earth. That's who you are. You're the Lord's people. We seem to forget that sometimes, and we get infatuated with those things that are around us. The world is not smarter than we are. They're not prettier than we are. They're not more happy than we are. They're not more intelligent than we are. They're not cooler than we are. They're just the world. And the Lord tells us very clearly, love not the world. Now, we will we'll all quote that. Everybody in this room can quote that passage. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. Every one of you can quote that passage. Because all that is in the world is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. We all understand that. We all quote it, and we teach it to our children. But we've got to live it these days in a totally different fashion. There has to be a line of demarcation between us and the world, the holy and the profane, the right and the wrong, the holy and the unholy, the righteous and the unrighteous. We've got to redraw that line that's getting erased. We've got to strengthen ourselves. Because let me tell you something, church, you're about all that remains. The devil has had his way with other religious institutions. He has had his way with too many politicians, academians. The medical profession is constantly compromising what used to be well believed and exact. Everybody's compromising now. And we had one group that came up and said, we want to change the marker on our birth certificate. I said, I beg your pardon. They said, we want to change the marker on our birth certificate. I said, the what? The marker. I said, what are you talking about? The marker on our birth certificate. I said, what are you talking about? We want to change the marker on our birth. I said, what in the world is a marker? They said, a marker that says boy or girl. I said, you want to change it? You want to change your birth certificate? Well, medical science has progressed to the point that they can snip and tuck and change and puff and push and pull and paint and rearrange, and they can make a boy look like a girl, a pretty good, reasonable facsimile, and can make a girl with certain injections look pretty much like a boy. Fact of the matter is, you know, some of your sons especially, our sons, are going to find somewhere in this country, there is a boy who's going to be wondering why they can't have a child, not knowing that the person that he is joined with is really a man who has been changed and altered by the medical profession. It's happening right now. It is already happening. There are a lot of things that we didn't want to talk about years ago that you better start talking about them. And you better start talking about them and praying about it and teaching about it and making a stand on it. Because the ugly reality is that this Pandora's box is open, and the demons that have come out of this box are extremely scary, extremely powerful, extremely rich, extremely well politically connected, and extremely successful at having 3 to 5% of the population control the debate in this nation, while our voices are muted and quieted, and we're shuffled over to the side of the road because you're irrelevant, because you believe that old Bronze Age book called the Bible that is irrelevant and has no place in the discussion today. Well, the Apostle Paul said, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. It's not about what John D. Berry can do. It's not about what your fine young minister can do, that your wise elders can do alone. It's us standing on the might and the power of the Lord. The Lord said, Peter, you're going to deny me. Peter said, no, I'm not. Lord said, yes, you are. Peter, you're going to deny me. Peter said, Lord, I wouldn't do something like that. Lord said, yes, you will, Peter. You're going to deny me three times. Three times you're going to say you don't even know. Peter said, Lord, how can you look me in the face? And you know I love you, Lord. I mean, I'm your inner circle. Me and James and John, we're the ones who are there when you need to cry and you need someone to listen. And when you fall down in the dust praying to your father, Lord, there is just no way that's going to happen. Peter stood there with great confidence because he had confidence in the power of Peter, in the power of Peter. And there are so many of us that have confidence in our own intuitiveness, our own intelligence, our own ability, our education, our wisdom, our maturity, our experience, and all of that stuff is good. Don't get me wrong. Don't stop using it. But then to top all of that off, to really make it strong, you've got to use the power and might of the Lord. That's why Paul said that. Peter said, I will not deny you. Don't you know that someone said, oh, you were with him? He said, no, I wasn't. Someone else came and says, oh, yeah, I remember you. You were with him, if you don't mind me paraphrasing. He says, no, I wasn't. I was not with him. Somebody says, oh, no, you were with him because your speech betrayed. You speak that same old broken stuff that he talks all the time. It said, and the Bible says he used whatever colorful language he had to use to make them understand, I don't know the man. Can you imagine that moment when Peter's eyes met the Lord's eyes? Can you imagine that moment when this good man, who eventually became a martyr for the Lord, who preached on the day of Pentecost, who helped baptize the thousands who obeyed, who gave himself wholly and totally to the service of the Lord, can you imagine at that moment of his weakness, when he had all this confidence in his ability and his strength, when he turned and he looked at the Lord, can you, in your mind's eye, go back a little bit over 2,000 years and see the Lord's eyes as they looked at Peter? Has there ever been a man who has been stricken more than Peter was stricken that moment when the Lord looked at him? I can imagine, my daddy used to say in a sermon, he said, you're so low you can sit on a dime and dangle your feet. That's pretty low. And I believe at that particular moment, Peter was just that low because he had confidence in his power. What we've got to do as the Lord's people is we've got to go back to basics. And I'm not saying you've left basics, so I understand what I'm saying. We've got to go back to that time when this was our and is our life. When standing for the Lord and preaching the gospel and pushing those things from one generation to the next, pushing them because it's not going to come easy. It became our life's work. So he said, brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. That word wiles in that particular context, the devil's trying to figure you out. He knows you're in the way of what he wants to do. This congregation, these elders, these deacons, this preacher, his family, all the beautiful families that are represented in this room, you're in the way. You're in the way. He wants to be able to come into Pulaski and have his way and just run through this city and run ripshod through this city and ruin lives and families and boys and girls and just put people into his prison camp. But you're in the way. You have the audacity to still preach the gospel. You have the audacity to say that the Bible is still the word of God. It is still relevant. It still reproves, rebukes, and exhorts. You have the audacity to tell people that Jesus died on the cross and shed his blood for our salvation, that he's not some comic book character. One of the magazines here recently, it may have been People, I'm not sure, that had 100 greatest people in history. And they got Jesus over there by Abraham Lincoln and Albert Einstein and Gandhi and Obama and other people like that. And there's Jesus sitting there in the corner as one of the great 100 people of history. Isn't it something that the creator of the world, who was there when man was formed from the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, he who was there when the sun was hung on nothing, the moon was placed in its place, when Eve was builded from a rib, is placed on the level of one of the 100 greatest men of history. Well, that tells you right there where we're going as a nation, because we are devaluing the name of Christ while we elevate the name of men. While we use the name of Christ in profanity and curses and disrespectfully, we're uplifting the name of politicians and businessmen and others who push themselves all over this country, in academia and the medical world and corporate America, wherever they might be. So the devil's trying to figure you out because you're in the way. So that word wiles means he's trying to find the formula, the pathway to your mind. And you block him out because you study to show yourself approved. That means you become diligent. You get busy about making yourself something different. You armor yourself, your mind, your heart, your soul, so that he can't penetrate. You let me know when it's time to stop. So in verses 12, he says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And this is what Paul is saying. You're not fighting, as I said a minute ago, you're not fighting Leroy, Cockroach, Bubba, and Skillet. You're not fighting them. You're not fighting the guy next door or your mechanic. You're not fighting the guy that installed your cable. You're not fighting the guy who walks around with his shirt collar on backwards. You're not fighting those guys. He says, that's not your enemy. He says, your enemy is higher than that. You look at those that make the rules and the principles and the laws, those that get in the hearts of men and the minds of men, and make them rationalize that good is evil and evil is good. He said, that's what you're fighting against. And whenever we get the idea that we can sit down on a seat of do nothing and lean back on the elbows or do less and say, y'all wake me up when the fight's over, you're the front line of the fight. You're God's people. You're the only folks who are going to quote the word of God, book, chapter, and verse. Speak what the Bible speaks in silent word is silent. You're the only people who are going to call wrong, wrong, and right, right. Everybody else have compromised to their creed, their catechism, their book of rules, and whatever they get together in their convention and vote on. You're the only folks that stay on the written word of God. You got to understand, you're on the front line. And the Church of Christ is public enemy number one. If you think they don't know who you are, of course they know who you are. Of course they know what you believe. And of course they know what you teach. And they're going to do everything they can to undermine you. Paul went on to say in verses 13, wherefore, take to you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand. You know, the Bible tells us if we resist the devil, he will flee from us. But he's coming back. So Paul said, withstand. You stand today. When he goes back and he looks at you and comes up with some new techniques and new wiles and new lies, he's coming back, you withstand again. And every time he stands, those men in this audience, you ought to put your arm of protection around your family, your wife, your children, and you stand. The women in this audience, you look at your family and you put your power and virtue in front of your family and you stand because God told you to do so. He commanded you to stand. And that's what we have to do. We don't capitulate. We don't compromise. We don't give in. We don't double talk. We don't go along. We don't accept what the world has to say. We're God's people. We're trying to go to heaven. That's what we're trying to do. The Lord said in John 14, when the apostles should have been doing all possible to comfort him, he comforted them. He said, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. You believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. I read that from time to time. There have been times when I read that and that's the only thing that strengthens me to keep going. To know that my Lord and my Savior has already said that I'm preparing a place for you. And if I do what he tells me to do, if I stand like he tells me to stand, if I preach like he tells me to preach, if we do those things he's commanded us to do, if we become the people that become the shining light on the hill, that no matter what everybody else is doing in this country and in this world, that they can always turn and pick out God's people because you stand out. You are that light. He said, be light. You can go to the biggest stadium. You can go to UT, and that's a big place up there in Knoxville. I've been one time and said, that's too many folks for me. But you can stand in the middle of that stadium in pitch black darkness and light one match. One match. You can go to that stadium as huge and massive as it is, where hundreds of thousands of people can sit at one time and watch the Vols play and strike one match. And guess what? From anywhere in that stadium, you can see that light. You can see that light of that one match in that massive stadium. That's why the Lord tells you to be a light. Doesn't matter how dark it gets all around you. Doesn't matter how many lies are being told. It doesn't matter what everybody else is saying. You be that one light, that one flicker that says, I'm the Lord's child. I'm a Christian. I'm God's child. And I'm going to heaven to be with my Lord. That's who you are. That's what God commands. That's what he expects. Let's strengthen what remains. Thank you.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace in the mansions bright and blessed.